be the reason why it took half a second to say, yes, please, can I come on this important day? But I just think it's such a good idea. This is what's needed, not, you know, yet another scholarly article that, frankly, nobody else is going to read, and not yet, you know, more millions of dollars thrown into well-intentioned, but sometimes not effective programming in education. What we need is this. I think what we really need is to bring these two worlds together. And in my own small way, I've been trying to do that, but I think at an institutional level, this is exactly what I would have done myself. So I know you can't read this slide. I can't even read this slide, and I'm closer to it. But I just want to give you a sense of what I mean by grid, and to show you what my scale sort of looks like as a blur up here on the screen. And if you care, you can go to my website and download a PDF and see how pretty you are. I have two kinds of questions on this scale, and let me tell you where they came from. When I started out in graduate school, having come from education, I had an intuition that it wasn't just talent that mattered for how kids would do, either in my math classroom or, frankly, beyond my classroom in the more important realms of life where they would go off and, you know, hopefully, you know, be successful citizens. It occurred to me very quickly as a teacher that how quickly kids learned for sure had something to do with their achievement. So I define talent as how quickly you learn. And I'm willing to say right here on the stage that there are kids who are more talented than others in given domains. And in my math class, I could teach Amanda something which, oh, got it, and then, you know, she's off to the races. Teach Hector the same thing, and it's like, okay, let me try it another way. All right, let's go number 3, 4, 5. And I'm willing to say that Amanda may have been better than Hector in terms of talent, right? But that wasn't the only thing. And again, any educator, parent, or former student, I think, has an intuition that effort really matters. The quality and the quantity of effort that a child or a grown-up can put to the task. And I wanted to understand the psychology of that effort, right? How can we get more high quality and more quantity of effort on task? These two questions come from interviews with really successful people, far beyond academics, but, you know, I just called the people I could think to call, people who had won prizes, people who were in Congress, Fortune 100 CEOs, and I asked them to describe the people they most admired. And two emergent qualities were the ability to stick with things, perseverance, this kind of like dogged tenacity, I will not give up, right? We've all been lectured about that, but that is half of the grit scale, it's the obvious half. The other quality that emerged in these interviews was a different kind of stamina. It's the ability to stay focused or interested in a given direction, in a given idea, in a given project, again, over extended time periods. But here, not so much the stamina of perseverance and resilience, but the stamina of your interest, which I would call, you know, sustained passion. So when I talk about grit, I really mean both things, right? Not only the perseverance over years, but also the sustained passion over the years. You know, you wake up every day and you're thinking about the same thing. So this is the scale that I use in my research, and when we get this scale to, for example, a cross-sectional sample of adults age 25 and up, I've got age here on the horizontal axis, and I have your grit score on the vertical axis. And the take home from this graph is that there might be one good thing about getting older, which is that in our sample anyway, the older adults were grittier than the younger adults. Now, in terms of what this means, I see two possible explanations. One is you mature. You figure out how to be grittier. You learn to be grittier with life experience. I think there's a good argument to make for that because the preponderance of personality research today would suggest that there is a kind of maturity principle that goes on with traits like grit and also things like emotional stability and orderliness and dependability and all the things that we have an intuition, and it's true, that we get better at over time. So maybe we do get grittier as we age. But it's also possible from this snapshot that those of us who grew up in the 50s or the 60s or the 70s may have grown up in a different culture than people who grew up in the 80s, 90s, etc. So there could be a cohort effect or a cultural lever here that's actually changing grit scores. Either way, and I can't tell from a cross-sectional sample, either way it suggests that grit is not a fixed thing. That it's not, you know, you have or you don't, you know, you're a 3.2 and you'll be a 3.2 forever. Either story suggests that grit has a malleability to it, and that's really what I'm deeply interested in. Will Smith is my, you know, I have a crush on him too. I kid you not, I write to him every year. I'm like, dear Will Smith, you still don't answer any of my letters, but I still love you so much. And I show your video, I hope that's not a copyright infringement. And he's actually from Philadelphia, so I will remind him that he's from Philadelphia. But anyway, what do you think? Will Smith is gonna walk through that door and like give me a kiss. And I just wanna play you 45 seconds from an interview where he's asked, you know, why you, right? Poor kid, you know, from Philadelphia, no connections. You know, why did you become one of the most important people in Hollywood?
The only thing that I see that is distinctly different about me is I'm not afraid to die on a treadmill. Right? I will run.
You will not be outworked.
I will not be outworked.
Right.
Period. You know? You might have more talent than me, you might be smarter than me, you might be sexier than me, you might be all of those things. You got it on me in 9 categories. But if we get on the treadmill together, right, there's 2 things. You're getting off first, or I'm gonna die. It's that simple.
See, now you're in love with Will Smith too. you know, it is an intuition that when Will Smith says, you know, you may be more talented than me, but you'll never outwork me. In fact, that's exactly what we find when we measure grit and talent in the same people. We find that these things are completely different things. You don't find a pattern where, well, the more talented kids are also the more gritty. In fact, either we find that there's no relationship. If I know how talented you are, I can say nothing about how gritty you might be. And in fact, in many samples, we find a weak inverse correlation where the more talented individuals are just slightly, on average, not everyone, but on average, a little less gritty. So it's interesting to see these things pull apart. And I think that's a message that I want to leave for kids. Like, you know, they might have an intuition. I mean, they're not blind to the fact that, you know, Susie next to them learned it twice as fast as they did. I think that it's, you know, it would be a disservice to say, like, oh, no, you're all equal, you're all equally talented. But the kid might say to themselves, well, Susie learned it really fast, great for Susie, right? But what can I do? I can try really hard. I can improve the quality and the quantity of my effort because I also want to achieve. Going back to 1869, I would argue the very first scientific study on achievement was done by Sir Francis Galton. And what Galton did was review the biographies of eminent individuals in society. He was not the nicest guy, I'll just footnote, but he wasn't the most enlightened, but I would say that what he did was distill the qualities that were common across all the domains that he looked at. So if you're gonna be successful in sports, if you're gonna be successful in art, if you're gonna be successful in the law, you might have an intuition that you need to be different things to be successful in those domains. But what Galton did was ask, what is common to success across every human endeavor? And to quote verbatim from his thesis, the truly eminent have ability or talent in combination with zeal and the capacity for hard labor. I would say that would be passion and perseverance, not only talent, but also passion for what you do and the capacity for sustained hard work no matter what. Now, Galton's somewhat better known cousin, Charles Darwin, read the first half of Galton's book and quickly wrote the following letter. He said, my dear Francis, you've made a convert of me, in a sense, for I've always maintained that men did not differ much in their intellectual ability, but only in their zeal and hard work. In the middle of the letter, he says, you know, you've made an argument. Maybe there are differences in ability that actually matter. But how does Darwin close the letter? He closed the letter and said, but I still believe that zeal and hard work are the most important differences. And in his own autobiography, written at the end of his long life and his successful scientific career, Darwin said that he was, to put it in a word, a plotter, not someone for whom things came easily. Not someone for whom anything came quickly, but somebody whose ardor, as he put it, for his craft, for observing differences in flora and fauna and people, and seeing what, you know, what the explanation was, that nobody would match his love for what he did. And he said, and I'm also willing to say that nobody would match my industry. Nobody would work as hard and for as long as I would on these scientific questions. If you fast forward all the way to 1920, you get to Stanford University. There is a psychologist there named Catherine Cox who undertook a study of 301 geniuses. Much like Galton, she decided to review their biographies, but in Cox's case, she amassed thousands and thousands and thousands of pages of primary biographic material, letters, diaries, and the like. And what she concluded of these geniuses was that the following: if you compare geniuses to non-geniuses, or in fact, if you compare the most eminent of the geniuses, which she called the first 10, to the least eminent, the slacker geniuses, right? Somebody's writing a PhD about them, but frankly, nobody else cares, right? So she called them the last 10. If you compare the high to the low geniuses, or geniuses to non-geniuses, you get the same pattern. And these are the two personality traits that really sort of jumped out at Catherine Cox as she was asking the question, you know, what makes these people different? And again, to quote verbatim from her own work, the tendency not to abandon tasks from mere changeability, not seeking something fresh because of novelty, not always looking for a change, right? And that corresponds to that consistent passion that I talked about being half of my grit scale. And then secondly, the obvious part, the tendency not to abandon tasks in the face of obstacles, perseverance, tenacity, doggedness. So here's a single sentence definition of what I mean by grit. Really, the emphasis here is on endurance, sustaining effort over time and interest over time, as opposed to fireworks intensity. So to put everything together in one equation, let me acknowledge talent. Let me acknowledge all the good work that's done on IQ, and let me say that I believe that we differ perhaps in our talents. That's not to say that I believe talents are immutable, but I do think there exist differences between people. And then the half of the equation that I'm more interested in, effort. For those of you who can remember your high school physics, distance equals rate times time. I think there's an analogy here, right? Because what is it to achieve something other than to go some distance from where you start to where you want to be? And analogously, I would say that talent is the rate at which you're making progress, and effort would be the time that you spend. In the case of human effort, it's not only the time in terms of quantity, but also the quality of your time. And I study grit because I think it's one of the big determinants, not the only one, but a big determinant of how much effort, the quality and quantity of effort that you put to task. So now we go all the way up to 2015, and what do we know about high achievers? What does the science of achievement say today? Since Cox, since Galton, since Darwin. This is a graph from Anders Ericsson. So raise your hand if you've ever heard 10,000 rule, 10-year rule. Raise your hand if you've ever heard that. So at least half of you. And I'm guessing that as many of you intended to read Outliers, and maybe some of you actually got around to it, this is the research of Anders Ericsson, a psychologist who studies world experts. So he studies, Olympic athletes and chess masters. He's sort of the world expert on world experts. And his work was popularized in Malcolm Gladwell's Outliers with documentation that, really it's thousands of hours of what Anders would call deliberate practice that seems to be a prerequisite for world-class performance in any physical or intellectual domain. And just to walk you through his graph, he has skill on the vertical axis, and on the horizontal axis, he has years, right? Years of deliberate practice. And there's this dotted horizontal line, which stylistically is to indicate world-class performance in no matter the domain that's being studied. And if you sort of drop down the vertical line of how many years that would be, it's true that on average, in some of his studies, particularly musicians, he found that on average 10 years, 10,000 hours across 10 years. It works out to about 3 to 4 hours a day, 7 days a week, 52 weeks a year, for a decade, right? It's an average, there's nothing, when the odometer flips from 9,999 to 10,000, it's not like, there's a puff of smoke and you become a world-class performer, but it does give you a sense of the magnitude of the investment involved. And I think the most important thing about Anders research is not widely known. And that is, it's not just the 10,000 hours, which of course is a shocking number, and we can all think about that and say, oh, well, this is maybe the reason why I'm not the Olympics, because I'm not putting in 10,000 hours. But really, it's the quality of practice. As I said, it's not only the quantity of effort that interests me, but the quality of effort And if you're doing all four of these things at once, you're doing deliberate practice. And if you're honest, you're not doing a lot of it. And the reason I say that is because even at the peak of their careers, Andres finds that world-class performers, on average, are doing a maximum of 4 to 5 hours of this kind of intense practice. And when you're developing, so some of the audience members might be younger, you know, it's absurd to think that a 12-year-old could do 4 to 5 hours of deliberate practice a day. Andres would say, and I know this because I asked him, I've got kids, and so I said, Anders, what do I do with my kids? I want them to do this deliberate practice. You know, should I shackle them to the piano? Should I, you know, punish them by withdrawing their cell phone privileges? And he said, look, developmentally, this kind of practice is so intense. You know, you can only expect them to do just a little, and if they don't, they're not doing any, you can only expect them to do maybe 30 seconds of it, and then work up to a minute, and then a minute and a half, etc. So just to give you a sense of, you know, what it's like, let me actually walk you through these four sort of definitional aspects. When you're doing deliberate practice, when you're practicing like an expert practices, you have a very specific challenge exceeds skill goal in mind. It's a very narrow aspect of your performance. So I'll tell you that, you know, I do give talks. I kind of care about being a better speaker. I mean, I care more about being a better scientist, but I would like to speak better, right? So if I said my specific stretch goal is to speak better, I wouldn't really be doing deliberate practice. What I really need to do is narrow in on some component, like I'm going to use pauses in a more intentional way in my talks, right? And then for the, you know, next practice session, all I work on are intentional pauses, so I can use silence to be effective, right? It's something that is very specific and very narrow in terms of the overall, you know, performance. When I say stretch and challenge exceeding skill, I mean exactly that. As shorthand, you can think of it as working on weaknesses, right? So when your kid is playing piano and it sounds great, and you say, oh, sweetie, that sounds terrific, you might not be praising deliberate practice. Because when you hear it, it's full of mistakes and pauses, and they have to go back again, and it sounds awful. That may be what you should be praising. You might say, sweetie, that sounds like deliberate practice. Awesome, right? It's hard, but I do it, and actually after a while, you get used to it. Concentration that is truly 100%. You know, it's interesting that when Anders studies these world-class experts, oftentimes they practice alone. So even the basketball great Kevin Durant says that he practices alone on the court, 70% of his time. And the last time I checked, basketball is actually a team sport. So it's really remarkable, like, why is Kevin Durant practicing alone when he should be practicing with other people, right? Logically, I think one of the reasons why is that it's actually very hard to concentrate truly 100% in what you're doing when there are other people watching, when you need to interact with them, where part of your consciousness is like, are they looking at me? Do they want to start over? Do they not want to start over? So a lesson to those of you with teenagers, as I have, you know, when in their entire day are they concentrating on anything 100%? No texting, no browser tabs open, no ambient noise. So, you know, a lesson from deliberate practice would be this. Third and fourth, immediate and informative feedback, right? We've known that from learning theory forever. But the proactive soliciting of informative, immediate feedback is, I think, so common sense, and yet I have yet to see the school or the classroom that really puts this into practice, right? When my daughter has to get something wrong and wait until Thursday to A, figure out that it was wrong, and B, get some feedback on what it was that she did, you know, incorrectly, that's not deliberate practice. The last step here is repetition, 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 repetition. That's actually a direct quote from John Wooden, the legendary UCLA basketball coach, who said that that was a crucial part of practice. Now, I don't mean to say that memorization is a, you know, terrific way to learn, but I will say this. It takes many, 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 many iterations to just get a tiny little bit better at anything. And so we have to teach kids that, you know, you shouldn't be like, oh, I tried really hard. Why am I not better, right? You try really hard, and you get this feedback, and then you try it again, and you know, again and again and again, and then you get a tiny little bit better. That's just the reality of deliberate practice. What does it feel like? Martha Graham would say that it feels like this. She wrote an essay for National Public Radio toward the end of her great career as a choreographer, and she said, it takes about 10 years to make a mature dancer. So again, this 10-year rule, it's irresistible. It's a that achievement is not easier than any other. There is fatigue so great that the body cries even in sleep. There are times of complete frustration. And my favorite line, there are daily small deaths, right? So this is actually pretty close to the description of what it really feels like to choose a specific goal, a weakness that you can't yet do but you're working on, to work on it with 100% concentration, getting immediate and informative feedback on all the things you're doing wrong, and then to start all over again. Might be a bit exaggerated, but I think it's directionally correct. And I think that's why we need to work on things like grit. Not only grit, but things like grit. These are important not because they're also things that we would like our kids to do in addition to being achieving, but they're part of what it means to be a person who can achieve their goals. So I see the work in K-12 and beyond schooling, pre-K all the way up through college, as being not, oh yeah, these character and social-emotional things are also important. They are integrally important into the accomplishments of our children. If we don't work on these things, I don't think we're going to have all the traditional success indicators like test scores and so forth go up either. At the National Spelling Bee, we've been studying grit. We mail home grit questionnaires to the 275 spellers who, you know, for the princely sum of a $25 gift card, are typically very happy to answer our questions and take IQ tests on the phone. One year when we did this study, we had students keep a diary of sorts. You know, what are you doing? And on a scale from 1 to 9, how effortful are these activities and how enjoyable? So effort is the right-hand cluster of bar graphs, and the enjoyment ratings are on the left. There are three kinds of things kids do to win the spelling bee. Deliberate practice is all the activities we coded in dark gray there. Things like writing the words down on a page that you got wrong 10 times in a row, memorizing word roots, etc. In the middle is being quizzed by mom or dad. So mom says, Usprache. You say, Usprache. U-S-P-R-A-C-H-E, Usprache, which was the winning word the year we did that study. And then, reading, that's leisure verb like reading, mostly reading, place travel, doing crosswords, mostly reading. And when you look at what kids say it feels like, in the dark gray bars, you can see that deliberate practice is, as Martha Graham would have anticipated, the most effortful but least enjoyable kind of practice kids do. But then when you tally up the hours and minutes that kids do with these different practice activities, and you ask the question, which predicts their actual spelling performance, you find that deliberate practice is tremendously more predictive of how well they'll do in final competition than the other two kinds of more enjoyable, less effortful practice. And of all the personality traits that we assessed, grit was the most robust predictor of how much deliberate practice you'd actually get done. So in a backwards kind of way, this is why I study grit. Because I think that gritty kids are able to sustain the interest and the effort on task that will enable them to do deliberate practice will actually make them better. For the sake of time, I'll just sort of speed through because I want to get to how to build grit, which I think is the most urgent question, and then of course leave time for our discussions and Q&A. At West Point, the first summer of induction is even in official West Point literature called Beast Barracks, because it's that hard, right? So these soft and squishy 18-year-olds, right, who come from all over the country and have spent 2 years trying to get into West Point, have to spend 2 months in this kind of beast training. And interesting, as a psychologist, some of these cadets, after spending 2 years trying to get into West Point, will drop out within those first 2 months. It's kind of like dropping out of West Point before it's even begun. And when you assess grit on day 2, the day after you get all your hair cut off, if you're a guy, anyway, and you look at grit, which is on the, you know, it's in this line here, so if you're in this dot here, you're in the top 25% of grit for the incoming cadets that year, you are, have a much better chance of actually making it through Beast Barracks than, for example, the lower grit cadets, cadets from the, you know, bottom 25% or bottom 50%. And we've run this study over 10 times in the last 12 years, I think it's like 11 out of the last 12 years, we get the same graph every time. Here's talent for West Point. The whole candidate score is a weighted average of your SAT score, your high school rank, expert psychologist appraisal of your leadership potential, and your physical talent as measured by objective things like 2 mile runs. It has no relationship at all with making it through B. Sparrows. Zero. Now, that's to say that this indicator has nothing to do with whole candidate score. If you stay at West Point, it's actually an awesome predictor of how well you'll do in terms of your grade point average and your rank in the military. But it doesn't predict showing up. And it was Woody Allen who said, 80% of success in life is simply showing up. And what we're seeing in this study is that talent is no guarantee that that's more, you know, that that's going to actually get you there. We have this Woody Allen study, we call it, actually, because all of these samples were recruited to look at showing up, including, with John Easton's help, a sample of high school students in the Chicago public schools. That's this middle graph. Grit scores are on the vertical axis, and it's very simple data. In the orange are kids who graduated from high school on time. In blue are the grit scores of the kids who did not, right? So kids who were off track, they maybe graduated the next year, or maybe they never graduated. So the grittier kids are more likely to graduate from Chicago public schools. Grittier sales representatives are more likely to stay in sales versus lose that job. And on the right are the Green Berets, the special forces officers who frankly made these barracks training look like going to summer camp. So the grittier Green Berets are more likely to complete training either voluntarily, or you know, the blue bar is the same whether you look at voluntary dropouts or you're asked to leave. So I think we've made some partial case, right? Some, like, grit is such a great word that I think it's kind of taken off, right? I mean, it's such a great word. And I know a little bit about it, right? I mean, I feel like the research has just begun. But I want to move on from documenting that grit predicts things to how to cultivate it. I think that's really the most interesting scientific question. And I'll start with Usain Bolt, because he is still the fastest human being who's ever lived on the planet Earth, which is just cool. And he's a paragon of grit. I put him up here because, you know, the first thing that I say to young people when I talk about grit and how I encourage them to cultivate grit in themselves is that it's very true that in deliberate practice, that gritty people will train their weaknesses. They'll pick a stretch goal for something that's, you know, for them, something they're really struggling with. But at the same time, I want them to remember that part of life is just figuring out what you're naturally interested in and what does come easily for you. So you should also remember to race your strengths, right? So this is more of a practical, I have zero data for this slide. I just have common sense, right? Also, I think it's an adage from sports psychology, you know, race your strengths and train your weaknesses. Usain Bolt actually considered cricket. He was on the fence, track, cricket. He probably would have been okay at cricket, but really, I think he made the right decision. So teaching deliberate practice is you know, one of the first practical things that our lab has worked on in terms of cultivating grit in young people. The slides that I showed you had no cartoons on them, which makes them not fun to watch if you're a middle school student. So we sort of, you know, gave the same content, but working with a graphics designer, you know, showing kids that the science of practice tells them that when you're frustrated doing something you can't yet do, awesome. Right? It doesn't mean you're stupid. It doesn't mean that you should give up. It doesn't mean that your teacher's an idiot. It means that you're working in the zone of discomfort where you might actually learn something. We tell kids that confusion is a signature emotion for learning. We tell them, when we show them videos, you know, taken from YouTube, of Olympic athletes and so forth, that failure is part of success. Right? You learn so much from screwing up and figuring out what you need to do differently. So we essentially put that all into a little, you know, interactive activity for kids. It takes about 45 minutes for them to do, and then we follow these kids longitudinally. This is a sample of sixth graders in a public school system near where I work in Philadelphia. And pre-intervention, the red group, which is treatment, is, you know, fairly similar to the placebo control group, which is in blue. And then the first follow-up, which is immediately after our intervention, we give them a deliberate practice math test. Levels them up. They're doing challenging things that they can't yet do. It's a little uncomfortable for them. And first of all, you can see that all lines are going down. Kids do less practice over time. But we can kind of buffer that effect. And the control group is dropping more precipitously. In other words, yes, learning about the science of deliberate practice may actually help you to do more of it, at least in this sample. We're also able, in the same study, to bring up the grades of the low achievers. So far, I have not been able to move the grades of the high achievers. But for kids who are below the median in their classes, prior to learning about deliberate practice, we are able to bring up their objective report card grades at least over one marking period. And then the effects start to tail off, and that's, you know, the work for the center and all of us to work on. In terms of encouraging a sense of, you know, part of what it means to be a persevering person, right? But where does this sustained passion, you know, I wake up and I'm still thinking about it, I wake up and I still want to do this one thing, where does it come from? Well, in my interview research, I'm finding that, you know, to really stay committed to something over years, you can't just be interested in it. It has to fulfill a sense of purpose, a sense of meaning, a sense of, you know what, it's not just interesting, this really matters. And if you ask me, who's playing Minecraft, right?